the interrogator. This is the interrogator speaking. Look here, Bibi. Here is the search warrant. The contingent are with me, but I left them round the corner. I thought I can manage on my own. We are looking for a piece of writing. What is the point in making a scene? Why don't you find it, fetch it yourself, or else where it lies, hidden in the house, show us, without a fuss. You yourself show it. Never have I seen my house in this light before. I can hear a heartthrob beat in its very walls. Blood drips from the veins of stone and steel. Warm breaths, wakeful eyes, parted lips surround me. Repeat their whisper to me once again of the promised eternal bond with my country. My four walls, dear land, nestle in your arms. The few moments of refuge I had, I owe you. Countless cellars arise before my eyes. Countless possibilities open their doors for me. Beneath my feet, open the tunnel of my hopes. All seven colors of life glowing on its walls. New words will be inscribed now on the walls of this city. O passing moment, I swear by your desecrated honor. Red is the dust around my house. Beyond this window blooms a red flower. All these tribulations over a book, hidden in my past? Look beyond the curtains instead, at my dreams of the future. So that's Femida Riaz. If you go back to our history even, it's very difficult to say, South Asia at that time. It was the old India. I mean, the subcontinent was British India, and the subcontinent is, like, so for me, Lahore or Dhaka don't feature as prominently as sort of foreign spaces. They feature as part of my history, because one, in the literature one reads, the history one has grown with. It's like, now tell me, I'm a Buddhist scholar of Buddhism, and I read about Gandhara, okay? And so much of my Buddhism is located in Gandhara. I don't see this as Pakistan, and therefore, people might claim it, but it was the old, the subcontinent was actually the old South Asia, and the South Asia is the old subcontinent. So that's how I see it. We have a huge landmass, which is now called India. And within that landmass is actually sections of what has been carved out as Pakistan and Bangladesh. And I think that they share a common ancestry. So for instance, if I'm teaching urbanization, I'm teaching about Harappa and Mohenjo-Daro, which is now in Pakistan. So how do I actually make a distinction between that history and the history of, say, the Gangetic Valley? I can't. The subcontinent actually has a geographical unity. And to that extent, actually, what I'm evoking or what I feel comfortable with, and what language-wise or culture-wise and so on I feel comfortable with, is something that, in a sense, is part of this long history. My generation was doing the crossover and doing it so naturally that you didn't even talk about it that much. But you came back. You came back with films. You came back with experiences. You spoke to each other. So there was a way in which the conversations were happening around you, even if one was not, even if you were not part of that history of going across. But my first South Asia experience directly, I think, was when I went to perhaps Kumari Jayawardena organized a seminar in Colombo, where she had all of South Asians at the seminar, and it was the beginnings of fundamentalism. It was the beginnings of the way in which fundamentalists were policing women's sexuality and across the board. I think the communal violence was also hotting up at that stage. And so it was fantastic because we had people from Lahore, we had people from Dhaka, and we had the Sri Lankans, and we were all over there.
Is Dr. Uma Chakravarti. She is, as all of you know, and perhaps have read this card.
I was invited by a publisher to prepare for the millennium a volume which was going to be an illustrated history of the ancient India.
It was something in the 2000s, and it was in Nepal. Now, in the usual style in which you do map making exercises, you know how there is a certain strategy of holding a workshop. So that was in full, fully being expressed over there. So we had people from different tension flashpoints. So we had people from Northeast, inner state. We had people from Sri Lanka, so there were Tamils and Buddhists from Sri Lanka. And we had Kashmiris, we had Hindu Kashmiri Pandits, and we had Anjum from Srinagar. We had these flashpoint tension characters. So I think it was an icebreaking mechanism that they said, you know, make a map and make a joint map. Now, it was interesting. Some could not make the map at all because the Kashmiris could not make a single map. So the Pandits made one separate one, and Anjum tried to make her own map. Some of us, Rubina Sehgal and me and so on, we were not from the flashpoint areas within. So we developed a completely different attitude. So we were full of this borders business, and the borders are oppressing us and not allowing us to cross over. And by then, you know, actually the European Union has begun to make sense to a lot of us, and we just, actually, what do we want? We want a borderless South Asia, you know, so that you can travel across. So we started to irreverently begin to make this map. The first thing we did was to abolish the boundaries and create bridges instead. So there's bridge this side, bridge that side, bridge in Nepal, you know, all over there are these bridges. How to do that? We can't do that without first dunking patriarchy. Because patriarchy has caused us to have those damn borders, you know? They are the ones who created the nation state. So we have to dunk patriarchy. So we make it the image of a guy whom we have dispatched into the Bay of Bengal. So he's being pushed out into the Bay of Bengal. And then we make this map, which is really inclusive. It has matrilineal homes so that nobody's thrown out of their houses and stuff. We do all of that stuff. And then we come to, but we said, we won't be able to do this world, you know, make this new world, because there's neoliberal capitalism, which is forcing us to behave, and warfare, which is forcing us to do certain kinds of things. So then we created neoliberal capital and put him, it's a he, we put him into a coffin and floated him down on the other sea. And it was amazing because all the women who had not been able to make their maps came around, and then they immediately vibed with this one, you know, and they said, yeah, this is what we should do, you know, this is our notion of South Asia. So that's how it all happened. To start with, I think it's not conscious that you think of the nature of your relationship with the state, but you are struck by, and I was struck by, the fact that there was very active movements both in Pakistan and in Sri Lanka, which actually took on militarization and warfare. What I was struck by was the fact that the women's movement, particularly in Pakistan, was very clear about its opposition to militarization and to state power, which was militarized. Their critique of the army is extremely strong and solid, and it goes back, it's probably the earliest that we have, you know. And also the conservative right-wing shift, see, the international geopolitics also of the region determined that they had to confront it. So you have the increasing Talibanization, which is, it's got its own international ramifications, because it's got the Americans, who are also very happy to set up the Taliban, because they are doing it against Russia, so in Afghanistan. The consequences of that is borne not by the Afghan women only, it's borne also by Pakistani women, because at the end of the day, the rightward shift that comes with Zia is coming because there is a Talibanization of the state. So this business of what you can wear, what you can say, what you cannot say, is all something. So it is felt nature of state power as a element in feminist thinking is imperative. You can't think of, you cannot actually segregate it and say, oh, this is a clean nation state and this is whatever it is. So I think that was one of the things that one, and to some extent that happened even with Sri Lankan experience. So in a sense, we also learned to reflect on our own investment in nation state and its politics, and the fact that we did not look at the challenges of what was happening in our own region. So, you know, whether it is Northeast or whether it is Kashmir, the challenge that should have come from feminists did not come, to my mind, early enough. Whereas in Pakistan, it was very much built into the way in which the Arab women's movement started off. Also because of the nature of the fact that it is that big demonstration that they had. See, they knew the their state was an illegitimate state, which is something that we've taken a long time to acknowledge. So there, it's the women who came out against the Hudud ordinances. See, Pakistan had its own history of reform. And in the 70s, in the late 60s, even right from the 50s, the women's movement has there been quite active. For instance, you know, ruling against triple talaq, bigamy also. So they were far in advance. Now suddenly they found themselves pushed back with the Hudud ordinances. Obviously it was ridiculous. And so the women came out on the streets in a large way. I will recall to you the crazy play that they created, which was two women, police women. You know, they are, and it's a really funny play, and it's Salima Hashmi, who's the daughter of Fayez and a famous artist, is one of the performers. The two women are there, and they've got, one has the cap, one has the belt. One has the, this is the police outfit. One has the top, one has the, and this is a hilarious farce that they create and perform on the street. So they're mocking at the stupid ordinary, this rule that Zia has created, that the evidence of two women is equivalent to one. But that's the funny side. The most serious side is that they are out there in large numbers in front of the High Court, and they get water cannoned, lathi charged, and imprisoned. It's the only I can think of early on, and this is in the time of Zia. So it was a very exciting moment. They broke the fear of the other sections on what Zia's regime was doing. So in that sense, I don't think we actually, in a sense, one was learning from each other. What's going on here? What's going on there? What's going on in Pakistan? I'm sorry, in Bangladesh. It was very moving to find, in fact, that Bangladeshi feminists, and this is Amina Mohsin is among the ones that I want to mention. Her father was in the Undivided Pakistan Army and posted in Lahore when 71 happened. They were interned in a camp. She had to take her exams, 10th class exams, school leaving exams, as a internee, as it were. So she grew up with that sense of, you know, this is what militarization, this is what nation states have done to each other. And at the end of the day, she now is a professor of international relations in Dhaka. Her way of translating this experience of hers is that she is very involved in the army atrocities in the Chittagong area, you know. So in a sense, what the histories of nation states and their oppressions, you surmount, you challenge it, and you actually mount a critique of those. So this is something that we all learned from each other. In 2001, there was a conference that was organized. That year, we didn't have the course. Instead, we had a conference, and it was a South Asian conference, and people came from across the region. On the 25th of March, 2001, that was 30 years after Pakistan Army invaded Bangladesh. It was a South Asian feminist conference, okay? And for 4 days, we are discussing this or that or the other. This is the last day. It's designed to coincide with that 30 years. The sessions are going to be on militarization, nation state, and all the rest of it. And Amina Mohsin and people have come, you know, from there. So that's happening. What we don't know is that Nigat has devised a plan. And the plan is that first thing in the morning, we would assemble at in a common space upstairs and open space. So we all assemble over there. And none of us knows that she's planned this. So it's 30 years after whatever it is. And the design is that, and she's seeking a memorialization of that event. Okay. And then she turns on Nayara News. So we're standing over there and she's given this little spiel, which is like the statement of purpose, as it were. And then she puts on Nayara News, Fez's Hum to Thehre Ajnabi Kitni Mulaqaton ke Baad. And then, you know, there's that line which says, Khun ke Dhabbe Mitenge Kitni Barsaton ke Baad. And I find myself standing with Amina on one side and Nazish Utaullah on the other side. Both their fathers were in the army in 1971. Okay, now they're all weeping. She's weeping. That one is weeping because it's a recovery of that 71 war and all the horror of that war and whatever. And so it's an incredible moment. And at the end of that, when we've all wept and done, you know, whatever it is, she says, we demand an apology from the Pakistan Army for the atrocities that they did against the women of Bangladesh. And this entire conference ratifies it, and that's the resolution that we pass. And it's an incredible moment. I don't think I've never seen anything like that in our lives. It's a full-blown distance from the nation state and its policies, and from the militarization and from the repression that they unleashed. For me, that is the spirit of South Asian feminist resistance and South Asian feminist solidarity. So I see that as some incredible way in which we were able to leave our nation states behind and, you know, engage with this history. And it wasn't funny, you know. I mean, I will ittifaq say I had Pakistani and Bangladeshi next to me, and that was the role of India, na? Hum bhi to shamil the usme, we were sending off our whatever it is. So it was really quite it was in a sense a chastening moment also, you know, to reflect back on 30 years. And it's never too late to say, it's never too late to acknowledge the wrong that you've done. We had the course itself it was an intensive 12 weeks course. And the first two lectures were a sort of general lecture around patriarchy and stuff like that. And then we went straight into history. Now, the biggest challenge was to be able to create a module of teaching history, which will take you all the way from early history all the way to the contemporary times. So that was the biggest challenge, and I had a whole week in which one could do this. The real challenge was to not be India, Pakistan, Bangladesh, you know. You had to think of topics which actually cut across all of that stuff, you know. So you could teach matrilineal, for instance. I did have a course on matrilineal, and you could choose matrilineal, experience of matrilineal in Kerala, in Sri Lanka, in the Himalayan regions. You could bring in polyandry, and you could also make those crossovers. In Pakistan, there are the frontier regions which have their own forms of marriage and property passing down. And so one was challenged to think out of the nation-state boundaries and think conceptually about the categories that we were foregrounding as feminist, as practitioners of feminist history. So that was my biggest challenge. And I think that that's where I was probably my most successful, most creative intervention came with the capacity to do that. That is traditional history being melded into the histories of this region, which was made possible by the feminist course. Because as a feminist, you could actually create your own course. I mean, who's going to teach matrilineal as part of history otherwise, you know? It was something that was available to us. So that's something that was the challenge as well as what was nice. And I managed, I think, to do that. It was also very exciting, the whole process of teaching in... we assembled, it was an intensive course. Nikhat, who was the dean of the institute, she marshaled the best resources in Pakistan for the teaching of the multiple other modules that existed. And it was very creative. So, for instance, women in space was introduced as part of the course in the in this 12 weeks, you have a segment on women in space. And the women in space is taught by an architect. So she introduces the subject, and then one day she does a little bit of concepts. The next day she unleashes you on the city. So you walk in the city, and then you start to get the excitement of seeing spaces divided, you know, where you are. And one of the most moving moments for me was to actually go to Dhyan Singh ki Haveli. Dhyan Singh had been some important ministerial official in Ranjit Singh's government. So there was a huge area which was called Dhyan Singh ki Haveli. The Angan had, you know, trees in it, and it was beautiful. It was absolutely beautiful. And then, so we went to this place and we were told its history. Immediately after partition, it was taken over and then as evacuee property, and then it became a police station. And then people in the neighborhood would hear, you know, sounds of torture and, you know, whatever it is, which was chilling. And then at some point, somebody decided to make it to a girls' school. Now, it was amazing because, you know, to have that space. And it was filled with these girls, you know, playing badminton, playing this, playing that and the other. And then these girls come across. And so you visit them and they come along to you and... they say she's come from the other side. You know, the other side becomes a metaphor for the one who's come from the border, from across the border. So this young girl, this is after Babri Masjid and so on. She says, is Ghalib's house still there in the walled city? And I say, yes, yes, it's there. I can actually proclaim that it is there. And I said, you come, we'll show you the thing. Because she's moved by poetry, so she wants to go and see this place, you know, see this place where Ghalib has lived and resided and so on. So it's so the history of spaces which are gendered, and then the history of nations that have grown in certain kinds of ways, all come together in that little encounter that you have. Very strong bonds developed. I think it was very rich also. I mean, I've never had a situation where your students are talking. There's a brainstorming in the beginning and you say, you know, who are you and where have you come from and all the rest of it. And one of the most moving accounts was this doctor who has come in. She's from the KW, she's from the Peshawar region, okay? Peshawar and even more interior. So she says that she's, how you come here? I mean, why has the doctor come to this course? You know, and then she says, most of my patients are men, but there are a few women, and they would come to me in a desperate condition, that is in only when they were close to death, you know, I mean, like in that situation. And then I thought to myself, what is it that, why don't they come? Why are women not coming to a doctor? And that led me to think of joining the course. So I needed to understand patriarchy in order to deal with this question in my head. So it had amazing experiences, amazing people coming in from different, locations. So that was very intense and very nice. One has heard Kishwar Nahid reciting Hum Gunegar Aurte. And the power of that poem in challenging patriarchy. We sinful women, I mean, what you consider to be sinful is our let's say, our ideological leaping board, you know, from which we actually challenge the nature of social relations around us. So, title was easy to derive. One managed to get older feminists, and we chose over there a dancer who would have been blacklisted in her time, doing Kathak. Then we had Salima Hashmi, who described the drawings, the Zia years, and how he tried to, you know, rule over artistic expression. And so she did a very marvelous presentation on that. And we had Femina Lewis, whom we managed to bring on the other side. Now, these were the older ones. So the younger ones included a poet from Sindh called Amar Sindhu. And from Chittagong, we had Hana, I think her name was. So she was working with the Chittagong refugees. Okay, so she was doing post, she was carrying forward the work of feminists over there. So when Femina Riaz, she's speaking, we don't let her speak without her reading that poem of hers, which is Tum Bhi Hum Jaise Nikle. And it's the key moment over there because it's so irreverent. It's challenging these characters and saying, chalo, itihas mein bahut hota hai, tareek mein bahut hota hai, but we know what's up, you know. So the irreverence of irreverence, but it's structured irreverence. It is not anarchic. It is actually taking on nation states, militarization, taking on patriarchy in its worst forms and so on. So that is the expression that event managed to capture in the form that we did, you know, over there.
वो मूर्खता वो घामड़पन जिसमें हमने सदी गवाई आपसे पहुंची द्वार तुम्हारे अरे बधाई बहुत Thank you.